Hey there, is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible, because it's the divinely inspired word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Sunday. Good to see you. Good to see you. And welcome to you that are live streaming with us or on the internet, on our website. I'm so glad you're with us today. I hope you're having a good Sunday. We're going to have a great Sunday this morning. Ready to worship the Lord? It's Amazing Grace. You want to sing about it? Clap your hands. Come on. Let's go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy. sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Want some more?
Yes.
Let's sing. Start at the top of the second column. This is Amazing Grace. He wants more.
Yes.
Here we go.
This is Amazing Grace.
Yes.
This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take. Oh, amen, amen. You may be seated. Wow, what a way to open the service.
Amen.
Great singing, guys. And the Lord is listening, and he loves it. And he's saying, give me more, give me more. And we'll give you more in just a little bit. Well, welcome once again, and so glad you're here. And feeling like spring outside a little bit, isn't it? Yes, praise the Lord for that. That's great. Well, let's look at the schedule for the week. Today, Christina, service at 3:00, and she's going to be preaching on Freedom is Yours. Yeah, I think we've all got something we feel like we're bound with. You've got bondage on. So she's talking about freedom today. So I hope you can either come back or listen on online, or it will be available later on if you get to listen to it later, but check it out, please do. Monday at 6:30, praise and worship rehearsal, and we are working on our Easter stuff, so don't forget that, praise and worship folks. Wednesday, 10 a.m., Women's Bible Study.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, praise the Lord, I love it too. If you're not able to come, but you're available, you know, and you have a computer and internet, we can always set you up with WebEx. It's very, very easy. We just send you an invitation through your email, and you hook in, and we see you, you see us. You can hear and see everything that's going on. So if you're not able to come physically here, and you would like to do that, just talk to me, and we'll get you all situated with that. 6:30, prayer time. As usual, and we just invite every one of you to join us, because we want to see God move in a great, mighty way in this place. Amen. God has great things in store for restoring hope, and we need to pray and pray people in, and we can change, we can move mountains with our prayers if we join together and pray. And we want you to join with us as we pray on behalf of those that we love that are suffering. But most of all, let's just hear from God. We pray and listen, and he has something to say to us, and we want you to be here to hear it too. Thursday, no Bible study with Christina. Saturday, the big day, big evening. Concerts of Hope are going to come back. And I'm going to let Max take the microphone.
I don't know about you, but I feel like I've been in hibernation as far as it comes to concerts. Went to my first concert just last Friday, had a great time with Sold Out Quartet, but we've got a concert for you. And we really want you to come. We really love for you to bring a friend, but Concerts of Hope are back again, back in the spring, and we're excited for it. And we're gonna have our very special guest, Ann Downing. She's one of the homecoming friends. And right now, we're gonna go with Bill Gaither back to a homecoming service, and Ann's gonna sing for us. Here you go, Ann.
There's a man in the Bible,
name of Jacob, wrestled God
for a blessing that he needed.
Got it when he reached the top.
We are climbing Jacob's ladder, rung by rung and step by step. Every rung goes higher, higher. Looking back just brings regret. Are you like that man named Jacob? Need a blessing?
Thank you, Ann. And she's going to be right here, Restoring Hope, this Saturday, 6 o'clock, and we look for you to come. God bless you.
All right. Thank you, Max. Christina, you want to come pray for us?
Good morning, everybody. And good morning, all of us that are on, maybe with one half eyelid open, on internet live streaming, because we moved into daylight savings, which you know, I think we did. And when I was praying about today, the Lord said, winter is over.
Amen.
So we're praying and releasing. Lord God, we thank you so much that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And Father, that is for us in this room, in this service today, those that are live streaming, those that are dead streaming, everything that's going on in this, we give you all the glory. And we thank you, Lord God, the joy of the Lord will continue. We declare and decree that as breakthrough over us will be our strength. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Let your message not just be for what we're hearing today, but when we leave this house, let us bring it into our own homes, families, and communities in a very special way. We thank you, Father. We give you this service. We give you our lives. We give you our hopes, our dreams, our disappointments. We give you our struggles, everything that we are dealing with as people. And we declare and decree that in you we are the people of God. Lord God, bless and let there be a special blessing on those as we come and listen and have our hearts open to receive. And Father God, let us hold up the banner cry that when we leave this house, we will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen.
I want to play just a little passage. I want you to listen to the way this sounds. Now I'm going to change one note. I'm going to take this note from here and put it down to the bottom bar. Is that not a pretty little passage? But if I strip some of these other notes away, and I leave two of these notes for us to listen to, listen to what I have. That's not so pretty, but it's a part of this. And my point there, those two notes are, we could call it a dissonant chord. It's a variation of a major chord, but I've got two notes that really don't go together. But when we put all these other notes with them, they sound so rich and so full. And so many times, what we see in our lives as Christians is that we can get along, we cannot get along. But we have to keep our mind on what our life is on this earth, and we have to understand we're probably the only group of animals on the planet that kill their wounded. And when somebody makes a mistake, we tend to almost kill them. And then that can not only physically but spiritually make these people devastated. That's not our job. Our job is to uplift and be together. No matter how much we might agree or disagree with whatever they're doing, we lift them up, hold them up. You know, if we want to point out, hey, maybe you shouldn't do that, maybe you should do this, that's okay, no problem. But we should always lift each other up, not tear each other down. You know, in Leviticus, there's a scripture that says, I am God. It says, I am holy. I am the Lord your God. I am the Lord. Now, God's not bragging. He's just trying to get through to some of us dummies that, hey, he's in charge. Okay, he knows what's going on, and he is making it all happen. Another scripture says to love our neighbor. Another one says love one another. Another one says faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. Another scripture said, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I've loved you. Of course, we all know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. John 3, right after that, it also says we should walk with and have fellowship with other Christians. We should be friends to people. We should appreciate each other. We shouldn't. If we have a Christian who makes a mistake, don't say, hey, dummy, you made a mistake. No. You know, go embrace him. Talk to him in Christian love. And say, here, I know what happened. Okay, here's what you can do to avoid that in the future. And then, just like what we saw in the video with the Gaither video, there was a song that I had listened to for many years and didn't really understand. And I think it was because I had never actually heard the verses to the song. And that's what I want to do today. They pushed back from the table to listen to his words, his secret plan before he had to go.
It's not complicated. Don't need a lot of rules. This is all you'll need to know. Loving God, loving each other, making music with my friends. Loving God, loving each other, and the music, it never ends. We tend to make it harder, build steeples out of stone, filled with explanations of the way. But if we'd stop and listen and break a little, that's how fellowship. We would hear our master say today, loving God, loving each other, making music with my friend.
But think about my favorite scripture right now, and that's in Acts, second chapter. It begins running the 42nd, 43rd verses, but it's talking about the new church and how they met together, that they heard the preaching of the apostles. They helped those that were needy. They prayed together. They ate together. They took the Lord's Supper together, and the church grew. Isn't that what he's thinking about? That's, I think, to me, that is the recipe for the church that God intended us to be, is that right there. And that's what we're trying to do here at Restoring Hope. We want everyone to be a part. It's like a family. We minister to one another. We encourage one another. We help one another through the tough times. And then we get excited and rejoice in the good times. That's what it's about here. And so we want more to come in, because there are people out there that are lonely and struggling so hard just by themselves. They need to come in. We can lead them and show them who's the source of the hope that never dies. And we can also show them that there are people that are real and truly love them. So let's pray them in, okay, and invite them. Let's continue our worship here and bless the Lord. Let's stand and let's worship the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
The sun comes up in sand. Really sing out now. Sing it to the Lord.
Be here with your presence.
We welcome the Holy Spirit today.
Fill me with your power. Live inside of me.
Come on now. Really sing out to the Lord.
Welcome, Holy Spirit.
Let's really welcome him with our voices.
Yes.
With open arms.
Be here with your presence. Fill me with your power. Live inside of me.
Yes.
You're the living water. Never drying fountain. Comforter and counselor. Take complete.
The people said,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Good morning, everyone. We welcome you here today. May the Lord bless you for being here today. This is the day that the Lord hath made, and we're rejoicing, and we are glad in it. And thank you for those of you who are watching via live streaming. We appreciate you being here with us today. And the Lord has something good for us today. There's no question about it. I'm excited about today. I'm excited about the future for our church. The Lord is just preparing the way, and he is making a way And I'm telling you, revival is here. And I'm so thankful for that. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise for all the things he has done. If you couldn't feel the presence of the Lord here this morning, definitely a problem. He's just so real to us. Isn't that amazing how real the Lord can be to us when we have a close walk with him? As I begin the message this morning, and most of you know that I always ask a question as I begin the message, but here's my question for today, and I'll ask for a show of hands, but how many of you who are in this building today have been ordained by God? All right. Three or four of you. All right, good, good. We welcome everyone, and of course, we'll talk about being ordained a little bit more in this message. Today, I'm going to go to the book of Jude, the book of Jude. Now, Jude is a really important book. It's what I would call God's handbook for survival. The title of the message today is, Don't You Dare Let Him In. Don't you dare let him in. Now, the book of Jude is one chapter, but it's packed full of a whole lot of information to help us live our daily lives. And I'm not sure how many messages I'm going to bring from the book of Jude, maybe just this one. I could probably bring three or four or five, I don't know. We'll just let the Lord direct us on that. In the next few weeks, we have Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday, so I'm not sure how many messages I'm going to bring from the book of Jude, but it's so packed full of good practical information for each and every one of us. So we'll see. We'll let the Lord direct us in that way. Next question. I want you to think about this. What do these schools have in common? Harvard, Yale, Columbia, and Princeton. Think about that. They're all colleges. They're all universities. In fact, most people consider them to be the best in the world. But that's not exactly what I'm talking about. So what do those schools have in common? Harvard, Yale, Columbia, and Princeton. They were all founded and built on one particular principle. They were all founded to train young men to practice law. No? What were they founded on? Biblical principles to teach young men to be preachers of the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All four of them. Can you believe that? I think they deviated from that just a little bit because it seems like they're doing just the opposite of what they set out to do. But I want you to think about this, even worse than those colleges deviating from what they were designed to do, the sad thing is, the same thing is happening to many churches across America today. There's no question about that. We use the word apostasy. I want you to think about this, and you know I love words and dig deep into words and see the true meaning of the words, but how many times do you think the word apostasy or apostate is in the Bible, in the King James Version? How many would you think? Somebody want to throw out a number? Max, what do you think?
Five.
Anybody else want to throw out a number? Four. Anybody else want to throw out a number? 12, 10, 31. All right. The word apostasy is a word we use quite often, especially when we're preaching the gospel. It's what it means a great falling away. A great falling away. That's what the word apostasy means. The word apostasy is found in the Bible, in the King James Version. We need a drum roll. Our drummer's sitting back at the back. All right. It is found in the King James Version. Zero. Dale said zero? Wow. Amazing. I could not believe that. I went to two or three online concordances because I knew the first one was wrong. I knew the word apostasy is in the Bible. It's not in the Bible. Not one time. But it's the word we use to describe what Jude was talking about in the little book of Jude. So Jude, he doesn't use the word apostasy, That's the word we use. But he's talking about people who turn from the faith. And it's sad to say a lot of people today turn from the faith. I mean, they start out on fire for the Lord. They're at the service every time the doors of the church are open. But something happens. Maybe they get hurt. And that's a sad thing. And I like the song Larry sang, we need to love one another. And we don't need to shoot our wounded. You who are spiritual, lift them up. That's what the Bible says. But it doesn't always happen. And people get hurt at church. That is sad. That's a terrible thing. That should never happen. And so there is a great falling away in these last days. And that's what Jude is talking about. He's even talking about how people do things in the church and teach things in the church that are totally contrary to the Word of God. Harvard and some of those other schools have deviated. But sadly to say, the church in a lot of areas have deviated from godly principles. They want to tickle people's ears. It's easy believism. And I'm thankful that the Bible says if you'll believe on His name and confess with your mouth, you will be saved. But we need to be sold out to the Lord. That's what I'm talking about. Amen. We need to turn our lives totally over to the Lord and give the Lord victory and defeat Satan. And it is possible. So the title of the message once again is Don't You Dare Let Him In. Into your heart, into your house, but into the church. Who am I talking about? You know who I'm talking about. Let's look at Jude chapter 1, verse 1. There's only one chapter. But this letter is from Jude. And I like the way this is worded. A slave of Jesus Christ. That's pretty cool. If we're going to be a slave to somebody, we need to be a slave to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I like the way that he described himself as being a slave of Jesus Christ. This letter is from Jude, a slave of Jesus Christ, and a brother of James. I'm writing to all who have been called by God the Father. Who does that include who's listening to my voice today? Everybody. Jude is talking to you today. If you're in the auditorium, he's talking to you. If you're listening via live streaming, he's talking to you. He's talking to all who have been called by God the Father, who loves you, listen, and keeps you safe in the care of Jesus Christ. May God give you more and more mercy, peace, and love. Now listen to what he says. He says, Dear friends, Jude speaking, I've been eagerly planning to write you about the salvation we all share. But now I find I must write about something else, urging you to defend the faith. He's talking to all Christians everywhere. We just established that point. He's urging you to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time to His people. He's asking you to defend the faith. Do you get that? I say this because, listen, some ungodly people have wormed their way into your churches, saying that God's marvelous grace allows us to live immoral lives. Did you hear that? Some ungodly people have wormed their way into your churches, saying that God's marvelous grace has allowed us to live immoral lives. The condemnation of such people was recorded long ago, for they have denied our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. There's a whole lot in that, would you agree? I mean, we could spend, again, several weeks talking about just those verses that we just read. But in these verses, there's no doubt Jude was concerned, and if he were here today, would be concerned about some of the things that are going on in some of the churches across America. And you probably caught what I read a minute ago, but if you didn't, I'm going to emphasize it. Before he wrote this letter, he was getting ready to write about salvation. the salvation that we shared together. He said this, I have been eagerly planning to write to you about the salvation we share. And that's a pretty good subject to write about. Would you agree? The salvation we share. But then, in my words, he's saying, and this is what he is saying, the Holy Spirit said no. Jude, you want to write about salvation, but I am going to tell you don't write about salvation. There's something more important for you to write about right now. And the Holy Spirit said, don't write about salvation. Write about how these apostates have come into the church. That's the word we use. The apostasy in the church. The great falling away from the faith. And it is happening today. And I'm thankful that it's not happening here at Restoring Hope. It's happening in churches all across America today, and we need to make sure it never happens at Restoring Hope Community Church.
Amen.
So Jude is explaining in this letter just exactly what the devil was trying to do back then. And by the way, he is trying to do exactly the same thing today, even at Restoring Hope Community Church. The devil has tried two main ways to destroy the church and to destroy those who serve him. Let me tell you something. When a person gets saved, that's when the battle begins. When the devil's got you, he's not going to bother you. But when you turn your life over to the Lord, that's when problems are going to really hit you hard. But I'll say this, greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. Amen. Amen. So give the Lord the victory.
Amen.
Kick the devil in his teeth. Woo. Resist the devil in the name of Jesus by the shed blood of Jesus Christ and welcome the Holy Spirit into your life.
Amen.
We need to pray for the filling of the Holy Spirit every Amen. Single day of our lives.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Some of you know I'm taking a college class. And that's one of the points that one of the professors made. We need to invite the Holy Spirit to fill us every single day. How often do we need to do that? I don't know. Every day. Because the devil's going to try to defeat you. But listen, if a glass is full, nothing else can get in it. If you're full of the Holy Spirit, the devil doesn't have a chance.
Amen.
If you're saved today, the Holy Spirit's living in your life.
Amen.
That doesn't mean you're full of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
That's why we ask the Holy Spirit to fill us every day.
Right.
Because if you're half full of the Holy Spirit, then Satan can have an influence on your life. But when you're full of the Holy Spirit, Satan doesn't have a chance.
Amen.
So let's be full of the Holy Spirit. He's tried two things. Satan has tried two things, and he's still doing both of them, but one of them he's kind of left by the wayside a little bit, and now he's trying something else. There's a great falling away from the faith. And so Jude explains what the devil was doing back then, and I'll say it again, what he's trying to do today. First of all, there was, and there still is, persecution.
Yeah.
But it was huge back then. Of course, it's no small thing today. But in the past, many Christians, especially when the church first started, there was a lot of persecution. There's still persecution today. But there's persecution and people have died simply because they went to church and or had in their possession a Bible. Did you know that?
Yes.
It's still going on somewhat today, and I'll give you some statistics, but it went on way back in Bible times, in the book of Acts. Some people back then, and even today, not so much in America, praise God for that, have given this choice, deny your faith or lose your life. Some people denied their faith. But many people have stood firm and their lives were taken. And by the way, the best thing, I know a lot of people don't think about it like this, the best thing that can happen to us as Christians is die. Amen? To live is Christ, but to die is gain. We don't want to go through that process, do we? But if you're a born-again believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm telling you, the best thing that could happen to you is die. Because you're going to be in heaven where there's no pain, sickness, sorrow, sadness, or death. But it's not God's plan for you to go there today, as far as I know. But until He does, we serve Him down here. And the Lord has a purpose for your life. If He didn't have a purpose for your life, He'd take you to heaven the day that you got saved. But He has a purpose for your life, and that's why you're here. Are you fulfilling His purpose? All right. Some people have died because they would not deny their faith. They were strong in the faith. Are you strong in the faith? We're going to find out in just a second. Are you strong in the faith? These people were. They would not back down from what they believed, even though they were threatened, and many of them lost their life because of their faith and trust in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And these people would let nothing stand in their way of attending church. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
These people would let nothing stand in their way of attending church.
Amen.
Those colleges have changed.
Wow.
Churches have changed. People have changed. It's a little bit different today. Well, let me look outside. If it's not raining, I might go to church today. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Those people would not allow anything to keep them from church. But now the smallest little thing happens and, well, I can watch it on the internet. And I'm glad that you're watching today. But if you're able to be here, you need to be here.
Amen.
And I know there's still concerns with our older generation about the COVID. I understand that. I'm not mad at you. But if you're doing everything else under the sun, going everywhere else, and you're not here in the service, there's a problem. There's a problem. And everybody in this building is saying amen. I don't know if you are listening to me via live streaming, but everybody here seems to agree with me. It's changed. That's what I'm saying. Those colleges have deviated. Christians have deviated. Used to, everybody went to church on Sunday morning. I mean, everybody. You ever watch the Waltons? They all went to church on Sunday morning.
Amen.
Now it seems like, well, if something better doesn't come along, I'll go to church.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Let's see how strong your faith is. And this is stepping on my toes too.
Yeah.
But would you be here next Sunday if what? Would you be here next Sunday if you knew the odds are pretty good that somebody could come in and take your life?
Wow. I'll be here.
Amen.
I'll be here.
I mean, you got to think about that one. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Come with my sword, for sure.
Come with your sword.
Right.
That'd be sort of nice there, Max. I want you to think about that. This happened back in Bible times, and it's still happening in some places of the world today, but people knew, and some people today know, that if they go to church, the odds are pretty good that somebody could come in and take their life. Well, if it's not raining, I'll be there. What about if you thought your life was going to be taken, would you come? I'm so thankful that we live in America where the odds are very, very, very low that that would happen. It has happened in some churches, we know that. But the odds are very, very low. And I'm thankful for that. But according to the Vatican, I did a little research. 100,000 Christians are killed every year because they will not back down from what they believe.
Wow. Wow.
100,000. And most of those are in the Congo. I don't know why. But statistically, most of those were in the Congo. I'm glad I did not have to say most of those were in the United States of America. We live in the greatest country on the face of the earth. Amen?
Amen.
According to Jeff King, president of persecution.org, 200 million Christians, 200 million Christians currently live under persecution.
Wow.
200 million. And he said that number is absolutely on the rise. So first of all, the devil tried, and he's still trying, to destroy the church through persecution. That backfired big time on him. I just got cold chills from the bottom of my feet to the top of my head.
Wow.
When the devil tries something, greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. I know I quoted that a minute ago. It totally backfired back in Bible times. Let me tell you how it backfired. During the early church, the Lord took a horrible situation and made something good out of it. And by the way, He has made that promise for you. All things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. It's true back then, it's true today, and it'll be true tomorrow because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen?
Yeah.
He took a horrible situation and made something really good out of it. Persecution in the early church caused the gospel to spread like wildfire throughout the entire world. How did that happen? The Christians who were being persecuted moved away from those places where they were being persecuted. The Christians did. But guess what? When they moved to other areas of the world, guess what they did? They shared their faith with everyone around them. It backfired. Even today, there's a saying among missionaries, the blood of the martyrs is the seed that makes the church grow. Because the seeds were scattered when the early church was persecuted. The Lord took a horrible situation and made something good of it. I think that's pretty good. Let me say this. If each and every one of us, let me ask you this question before I get to the next one. Are you willing to live for the Lord? Amen?
Amen?
Okay. Are you willing to die for the Lord?
Amen. Amen. Wow.
I want that to soak in a little bit. I'm going to live my life for the Lord. I'm willing to die for the Lord. Can you say that? And it's easy to say, but if somebody had a shotgun sticking to your head and say, deny the faith or you're going to die.
Call me gone.
Call me gone. Amen. Amen. But it's a lot easier to say than when we really think deeply about somebody with a gun to our head saying it. You're willing to live for the Lord. You're here today. You're watching today. Are you willing to die for the Lord? if we would get to the point where we would be willing to die for the Lord, rather than letting the smallest piddly little thing keep us from serving the Lord, that's when the work of the Lord is going to grow like wildfire. Amen?
Yeah.
Or oh me. Amen.
Amen.
I've given you a lot to think about. If we're willing to die for the Lord, that is when the work of the Lord's going to grow like wildfire. And if the devil does come in and try to stamp it out, you know what's going to happen? Instead of putting out the fire, he's just going to scatter the embers like he did in the early church. And the work of the Lord will go even further than it would have if he wouldn't have come in to try to stomp off out the fire. New work for the Lord would begin elsewhere. So he tried persecution, and it worked a little bit, but not like he thought it would, because he thought persecution with the early church would just completely annihilate the church and get rid of it. So he said, what can I do different? He's doing something different today to go along with the persecution. It hasn't stopped, as was obvious by some of the statistics I gave you. But now he's trying something else because it's not working exactly like he had planned. Have you ever heard this? You have. If you can't beat them, join them. Satan figured out, if I can't defeat him from the outside with persecution, why don't I go inside with infiltration? That's what Satan's doing today. We're not going to go this deep today, but there are many churches that the pastors preach 98% the truth and 2% lie, and that 2% is what's keeping people from going to heaven and sending them to hell.
Amen.
They're preaching 98% of the truth, but if they don't teach the way that the Bible teaches about salvation, there are people in churches today with praise and worship teams, with a preacher of the gospel, thinking they're doing the right thing, but they're going to end up in hell because the devil has the preachers preaching just enough deception that they don't even know how to be saved. That's a scary thought. Listen, don't ever take my word for anything. I'm serious about that. Everything I say, I would like for you to go home and study on your own to make sure that I'm telling you the truth. Study to show yourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. It's a scary thing. Are you getting it? The churches are preaching the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with a wonderful praise and worship team, and yet there's not enough truth in there to get the people to heaven. That's what Jude's talking about. Jude verse 3. I find that I must write about something else. I was going to write about salvation, which all of us are excited about that, urging you to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time to His holy people, to you. What was the problem back then? What is the problem today in many churches? We can see what it is in verse 4. Jude was writing about the apostates. Even though it doesn't use that word, he was writing about those who were turning from the faith. Some of them were remaining in the church. Some of them were standing behind the pulpit, and they were turning from the faith. And Jude says in verse 4, for there are certain men, crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. And that means unrestrained sexual behavior, in case you wondered. Turning, listen to it, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. Did you hear that? People who claim to be Christians are turning the grace of God into lasciviousness, unrestrained sexual behavior, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Today, we ordain people for the work of the Lord. Amen? We do that as a church. We ordain people for the work of the Lord. Over the years, in this building alone, we have ordained at least three. I can think of three right off of the bat. In this building, in this auditorium. So, let's go, and Christina was one of them. Let's go back to my first question. How many of you in this building are ordained of God? Raise your hand one more time. All right, three or four of you. Wrong. Nope. It's not three or four. So which one of these three or four has not been ordained? All of you have been ordained. And I just got cold chills again from the bottom of my feet to the top of my head. You've all been ordained. You are, if you're a born-again believer, you are ordained. You are an ordained minister of Jesus Christ. You can walk out the door and say to anybody, I'm ordained. I'm an ordained minister of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Do you want the verse to back it up? I just happen to have one. Does that surprise you? John 15, 16. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you. He has chosen you and ordained you. Now, don't get messed up with predestination to salvation. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But once you're saved, you're predestined to live for the Lord. There's a difference. That's another message. But don't get confused on that one. He's chosen you. He's chosen everybody to be saved. Some people refuse his gift. He's chosen you and he's ordained you. Lisa, how you doing, Lisa? Lisa got saved last Sunday. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Last Sunday, she was a dirty old sinner. Today, she's an ordained minister of the gospel. That's cool. I like that. That just hit me. We were all that way. Dirty, rotten sinners headed for hell. But Jesus gloriously saved us, and the day he saved us, we became ordained ministers of Jesus Christ. I'm getting cold chills all over the place. I don't know if you know it, but this is pretty good preaching today. I'm just saying.
Amen.
Because I'm preaching his word. That's why. I have nothing to do with it except I'm his messenger. All right. You have not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. I'll say it again. If you are saved, if you've received the Lord Jesus Christ as your own personal Savior, if you're a Christian, you are ordained by God. He has ordained you to go and bring forth fruit. He has ordained you to win others to Christ. Are you fulfilling your purpose? Now, do you realize that Satan also has ordained ministers? That's what verse 4 is talking about. Listen to it again. Who were before of old ordained to this condemnation? Ungodly men, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. The apostates are very clever. They were back then and they are today. They come in very quietly into the churches. One version says they worm their way in. The other version says they creep in unawares. Nobody is aware of their deceitfulness. They seem like godly people coming into the church. And by the way, that's why the Bible says, try every spirit to make sure they're of God. Amen?
Amen?
They come in very quietly. They worm their way in. And just like a termite, what's a termite do? They destroy a house from the inside out. That's what apostates are doing in many churches across America today. And that's why Jude wrote this book. He's giving us a warning. That's the introduction to my message. Let me go in one more point. It's a few minutes before 12. Let me go briefly into one more point. I want you to think today about the faith. I'm talking about the faith. And by the way, that is the wording that Jude uses concerning the Word of God, concerning what we believe. He calls it the faith. I like that. And so, first of all, I want you to think about this, the completeness of the faith. It's complete. The Word of God is complete. And he says this in verse 3, Beloved, while I was giving all diligence, we read this a minute ago, to write unto you the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend, fight for the faith, which was once delivered unto the saints. Now listen to that wording. Earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. Did you hear that? Our Bible, King James, says it was once delivered unto the saints. It literally means, if you go back to the original, you're going to find this out, it means once and for all. It was once and for all delivered unto the saints. Now, I really wanted to bring this message out, this point out, because you may not understand how the apostates are coming in and we don't even know it. I'm talking about sometimes preachers of the gospel. God gave us this message right here. It was written by men, but inspired by God.
Amen.
And it's God breathed. That's what it means. It was written by men with their own personalities, but God inspired them to write what He wanted written.
Amen.
Okay? You'd never have that many authors without one disagreement if it weren't for God. He gave us the message. And listen, nothing should be added, and nothing should ever be taken away. In fact, there's a very strict warning about people who mess with God's Word. And some preachers are doing it. Revelation 22, 18 and 19. For I testify unto you, unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these words, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. Well, let me give you a few of them. I won't give you all 10 right now, the 10 main ones. Boils, water into blood. Can you imagine every flowing river, every stream, every ocean, every lake being a lake of blood? Can you imagine going to the drinking fountain, pushing the button, and blood would come out? I mean, if they had drinking fountains back then, that would be what would happen because the water turned to blood. Locust and death. Those are a few of them. And it says if you had anything to it, then God will add the plagues to your life. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. Now, we definitely live a day and age where many religions have added to the Word of God, and they've taken things out that they don't like. Did you know there are some churches today that are taking the word blood out of the Bible and out of their songs? Any song that has the blood of Christ, either they change it or they take it completely out of their songbook. There are a lot of churches that are adding to the Word of God. There are a lot of churches that are taking things away. And that's the reason we have so many different religions today. It's the reason we have cults today. Because they take just what they want and then they add to it or take it away. Joseph Smith, the founder of the Mormons, he wrote the Book of Mormon. Right? Why? Want me to tell you why? Because he said the Word of God is not complete, and God has given me the mission to write the Book of Mormons to complete the Bible. Did you know that? Are you hearing what I'm saying? I have some very good friends who are Mormons. Mormons, I think, I don't know. Let me just say what I was going to say, and you can dispute it. But there's not a religion that has people with more integrity than the Mormons. I mean, most Mormons, their integrity with a capital I. You know what I'm saying? And I've talked to my Mormon friends. And they agree with 99% of what I preach. We cannot add to or take away from the Word of God. God's Word is complete exactly the way it is. We don't need any new revelations when it comes to the Word of God.
Amen?
Amen.
If
somebody says, I've received a new revelation concerning adding to or taking away from the Word of God, it did not come from God. Mark it down, it came from Satan.
Right. Amen.
Now, don't misunderstand. I'm not talking about how the Lord reveals things to us and we could use the word revelation. He does reveal things to us. He revealed several things to me for this message this morning. He reveals things to Christina every week, to Max and the others. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about when somebody says, I'm going to add to or take away from the Word of God. So the Lord gives us new insights. Sometimes we call them revelations, and that's okay as long as we know what we're talking about. but he is not going to give anyone a new revelation the way that he did, for instance, for John, who wrote the book of Revelation. It's complete. Don't take anything away from it and don't add anything to it. It was once and for all delivered to the saints. Nothing should be added. Nothing should be taken away. We just need to be careful. God is so good, isn't he? He's just so good. But we need to be careful that we don't allow somebody to come in and start a little Bible study. We like Bible studies around here. Start a little Bible study and 98% truth and 2% error. We got to be careful about that. How are you going to know? I already said, you study yourself to show yourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That's your responsibility. I'll say it again. Don't take my word for anything. Make sure that I'm not preaching from the Reader's Digest. You know what I'm saying? Because some preachers do. Make sure that I'm right on point on everything that I preach. I want you to do that. And if you find something that I'm in error, come to me. I make mistakes. I'm not misinterpreting salvation, I'll guarantee you that. But there's little things that could be misinterpreted. And there were things that I believed 30 years ago that I've totally changed on. Christina. I mean, when I started out, well, women aren't supposed to be preachers. The Bible says, let the woman keep silent in the church. I mean, that's the verse we used. It has nothing to do with a woman preacher. There's deacons in the Bible. There's prophetesses in the Bible. And if you don't agree with that, you're going to find out you were wrong, just like I did, once you get to heaven, if you don't find out before. How did I get off on that? I don't know. Oh, I was saying that there are things in the Bible that I misinterpreted early on. And maybe there's something small that I'm misinterpreting today. So you study and you find out. And if you have a disagreement, let me know. On the major doctrines, I'll guarantee you I'm not wrong, okay? That's what I'm saying. The Lord loves you. He wants the best for you. And the best decision that you can make, if you haven't made it already, is to accept the Lord as your own personal Savior. Here's what I would encourage you today. If you don't get anything else out of the message today, get in the Word of God and study it. This college class, I've spent more time studying in the last 5 weeks. I've been up till 11 and 12 o'clock at night. I've written, how many papers now? 30 papers, and it took me on average 4 hours for each paper in the last 5 weeks. So I've studied more in the last 5 weeks. I study hours to prepare for my messages, but I'm digging deeper than I've ever dug. It is so cool. I spent 9 hours writing one paper on Saul, and maybe you saw it on Facebook. Took me 9 hours, but I learned so much. It's so exciting to learn things you've never seen before. You're not going to do that if you don't study the Word. That's the bottom line out of this message. If you don't get anything else, get in the Word of God and study. Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll bless during this invitation time. Speak to hearts. Lord, I pray that if there's a decision that needs to be made today, whether it's those who are in the auditorium or those who are viewing via live streaming, I pray that you'll speak to their heart. Just make it clear what decision needs to be made, and then I pray that we'll yield to the leading of the Holy Spirit and make those decisions. I pray that when we leave this place, each and every one will be able to say, there's nothing between my soul and the Savior. Everything's good. And I pray the same thing for those who are viewing today, live streaming. Speak to heart. I pray that decisions will be made. Have your will in our lives, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. The altar's open. We encourage you to come to the altar if you'd like to pray with somebody. We'll pray with you here at the altar. If you'd like to talk to somebody in private, we'll take you to the prayer room and show you from God's holy word what you need to know, especially how to know for sure that heaven's going to be your eternal home. But if you just ask the Lord, Lord, is there anything in my life that needs to be changed? That's what I'd encourage you to do. And then just be still and know that He's God. Just listen for His voice to your heart. Maybe not to your ears, but to your heart. He'll speak to your heart. He loves you. He cares about you. He wants the best for you. And so if there's something that's putting a damper on your relationship, I'm sure He's going to point it out to you. So just listen to Him and then yield to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Let's stand as we sing. If there's a need, would you come on the very first verse? Just as I am without one plea. Come on now. Just as I am without, but that Thy blood was shed for me, and that Thou bidst me come to Thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Who else will come? Allow the Lord to work in your heart today. Would you come on the second verse? Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to Thee whose blood can cleanse, we're going to sing one more verse. This will close the invitation. If there's a need, would you come on this last verse? Come on now. Just amen. You may be seated. Would you like to hear one of the papers I wrote? You have a few minutes, maybe 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Some of you saw it on the internet on Facebook. This was my last assignment for this class. So as of midnight tonight, this class, its leaders on leadership, is done. But my last assignment, this week has been writing about self-care. Somebody in the Bible that really took care of themselves? I chose Jesus. Somebody in the Bible who did not take care of themselves? I wrote about Saul. That's the one that took 9 hours. And then my last assignment was interview somebody that does manifest self-care. So this is what I wrote. I have a very good friend, Garvin Adamson. You mind if I read this? I should ask you. Who is our bass player at Restoring Hope? He's a very good friend, but come to think of it, he's not half the man he used to be, almost. Garvin was born at a very early age, 9 months. I got my jab in there to the abortionist because life begins at conception, right? So when you're born, you're 9 months old. Can I get an amen on that one?
Amen.
All right, I had to get that in there. And he was fearfully and wonderfully made. Garvin, like many of us, struggled with his weight. When he was in the third grade, it became apparent to him that he had a problem. He was bigger than most of the kids in the class. To make things worse, the other kids began to pick on him. Depression set in. When Garvin was in high school, he was 5'8", 220 pounds, but by the time he was 30, he had tipped the scales at 300 pounds. His excessive weight caused him to have very serious health problems. He had very severe pain in his back, hips, knees, and ankles. When he sat down and moved his ankles, it was like popping popcorn. Garvin didn't realize how serious his problems were. He just thought everyone had those problems at his age. Because of all the pain and because depression had set in, once Garvin got home from work, he did nothing as far as physical. He sat down and drank a 2-liter Pepsi every night and could easily eat a half a gallon of ice cream at one sitting. I can relate to that. Garvin's dad passed away at age 58. His dad was also very heavy. And by the way, I interviewed Garvin one night this week, and we had such a wonderful time, didn't we? I mean, I'd say we spent an hour and a half or so, I think. Just had a wonderful time of fellowship. Garvin's dad passed away at 58. His dad was also heavy, had heart problems with sugar diabetes. Garvin was closely following in his dad's footsteps. Most of the relatives on his dad's side had the same problem, struggled with their weight. Garvin looked in the mirror at the age of 47. That was 11 years less than his father's age when he died. And it was like a light bulb came on. He said to himself, if I don't change today, I'm going to be dead in a short period of time, just like my dad. Going back a few years, Garvin, when he was 15, his family went all across the Midwest from church to church singing the praises of the Lord and preaching the gospel. They preached and sang just about every Sunday from 1973 to 1991. In fact, that's how I met Garvin. His family ministered at our church at Kessler Crest in the early 1970s. By 1992, Garvin joined the Gospel Servants Quartet. And again, just about every Sunday, just like with his family, they were out praising the Lord in song. And he was with the Gospel Servants until 2006, which they also came to Kessler Crest. For a while, they were coming twice a year. Garvin accepted the Lord as his personal Savior when he was a teenager. But even though he was ministering through music in a different church just about every Sunday, listen to this, at the age of 30, he drifted away from the Lord. Yes, for several years he was ministering in a church just about every Sunday, even though his relationship with the Lord was in serious trouble. The light bulb came on for Garvin in June of 2005 when he was 47 years old. Garvin realized he was in a mess physically, but even worse, he was in a mess spiritually. The day the light bulb came on is the day that things changed completely for Garvin, both physically and spiritually. He knew his weight problem led to depression, which was the primary cause of his drifting away from the Lord. For Garvin, surgery wasn't an option, but he knew he couldn't fix the problem on his own. He was totally overwhelmed, so he turned his physical, emotional, and spiritual problems entirely over to the Lord. That day, the day the light bulb came on, he went through his house, found all the junk food, threw it in the trash, and joined Cardinal Fitness Health Club all that same day. It took about a year for Garvin to figure out precisely the best way to tackle his weight issue, but he started immediately. First of all, he set some goals. Garvin heard that if you had a waist that was over 38 inches, you were at high risk for sugar diabetes. Garvin's first goal was to lose 20 pounds and get down to at least a 38 waist. What is your waist today? 31. He's really wasted away. He didn't know exactly how to start, so he watched The Biggest Loser, which inspired him. Garvin followed their basic routine. From day one, he went to the gym 3 days a week, walked 5 miles the other 3 days a week, and then he rested on the seventh day. Seems like somebody else did that. You know what I'm saying? In 2 years, Garvin went from 300 pounds to 180 pounds. To date, his total weight loss is 135 pounds. In other words, he's about half the man he used to be. He's 165 now. The first time I talked with Garvin about his weight loss, I asked him, "How did you do it?" And he said, "It's really simple. Eat right and exercise. That's all there is to it." He said, "You need to eat to stay alive instead of eating for comfort." Over the last few years, Garvin has run approximately 175 events, including hundreds of 5Ks, 10Ks, 15Ks, and in 2015 he ran a 50K, which is 31 miles. From 2010 to 2018, he ran 34 half marathons, which are 13.1 miles, and 8 full marathons, which are 26.2 miles. Garvin now weighs 165 pounds, goes to the gym twice a week, rides his bike approximately 10 miles a day. How many did you ride yesterday? 20 miles yesterday. When the weather is good, and is preparing for the Gap Trail Ride, a bike ride from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania to Washington, D.C., which is 335 miles. Over how many days?
Seven
days. 335 divided by 7 is a whole lot of miles a day. Garvin said it was challenging to be spiritually and mentally, healthy when he was physically unhealthy. He also said most of his physical challenges were mental. He said, "My brain said, don't do it. The devil said to do it." He said, "I know Satan wants me to do things that I shouldn't do because he wants me to be miserable and fail. Being overweight made me miserable and caused me to fail." Garvin had no surgery, has no eating disorders. He just is concerned about his health, and by the grace of God, the victory has been won. His weight loss did create one problem for him. When he presented his driver's license at the license branch, they saw the big picture and they didn't believe it was him. Today, Garvin is enjoying a life that was impossible to enjoy when he was not taking care of himself. He has a very healthy outlook on every aspect of his life. Garvin looks at life as an adventure and living life to its fullest. He is physically fit, emotionally stable, and spiritually sound. When I interviewed Garvin last night, which was a couple of days ago, he had a glow on his face that lit up the room. Garvin has a smile on his face and joy in his heart. His goal for today and in the future is to glorify God with his body, mind, soul, and spirit, and help others overcome their obstacles just like he did. He said, "I want them to realize no one has to live in defeat. By helping others, it makes me feel good and gives me a sense of purpose. As the value of your self-worth improves," this is his words, "as the value of your self-worth improves, your relationship with the Lord improves." Today, I will say, his relationship with God is great. All right. That's pretty amazing. Would you agree? Yep. He's inspired me. I got a weight room upstairs. Did you know that? It's waiting on me to come use it. That's why they call it a weight room. All right. We're proud of you, Garvin. And you are an inspiration to all of us. That's for sure. And I know that I need to make some changes in my diet also and exercise. And I have made some changes and making many, many more. Need to, for sure. We've only got one body. I guess we need to take care of it, for sure. All right. Let's lighten the load a little bit and empty your pockets and put it in the offering plate. You'll be a little lighter when you leave than when you came. Heavenly Father, thank you for your blessings, for everything that you've done for us and for the day that you've given us. And now, Lord, we pray that you'll bless this offering. Have your will in our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Said amen.
Amen.
Do you know why I can level with you about the weight problem? Because I got the bubble right in the middle. I can level with you. The bubble in the middle on the level, you know. Okay. JD, why don't you come dismiss us in prayer?
Lord, we have been blessed today with great testimony, with great preaching. Now let your Spirit indwell us as we go forward. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Mm.